Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari Jaya Radha Madhava. Gopi jana vallabha giri varadhari. Gopi jana vallabha giri varadhari. Rajana Yashodanandana Brajajana Ranjana Yamuna Tira Vanachari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Rama, Rama Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Together, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna,
Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
One last time, please. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. కలియుగ పావన హరినామ సంకీర్తనకి అనంత కోటి వైష్ణవ వృందకి హరే హరే. ఓం నమో భగవతే వాసుదేవాయ. ఓం నమో భగవతే వాసుదేవాయ. ఓం నమో భగవతే వాసుదేవాయ. నారాయణం నమస్కృత్య నరం చైవ నరోత్తమం దేవీం సరస్వతీం వ్యాసం తతో జయముదీరయే నష్టప్రాయేష్వ భద్రేషు నిత్యం భాగవత సేవయా. భగవత్యుత్తమ శ్లోకే భక్తిర్భవతి నైష్ఠికీ. కృష్ణాయ వాసుదేవాయ దేవకీ నందనాయ చ నందగోపకుమారాయ గోవిందాయ నమో నమః. సో వెల్కమ్ ఆల్ ఆఫ్ యూ ఫర్ ద కృష్ణ రసాయనం బిగినింగ్ ప్రోగ్రామ్ టుడే. లాస్ట్ ఇయర్ ఆల్సో వీ హ్యాడ్ దిస్ ప్రోగ్రామ్ ఓన్లీ ఫర్ లిమిటెడ్ గ్రూప్ ఆఫ్ సమ్ 120 లీడర్స్ ఆఫ్ హైదరాబాద్ కాంగ్రిగేషన్. సో మెనీ ఆఫ్ దెమ్ లేటర్ ఆన్ టోల్ మీ ఇట్ వుడ్ బి నైస్ ఇఫ్ యూ ఓపెన్ ఇట్ అవుట్ ఫర్ ఆల్ ద కమ్యూనిటీ మెంబర్స్. సో ఇట్స్ అ వెరీ ఓవర్వెల్మింగ్ రెస్పాన్స్ ఫ్రమ్ సో మెనీ డివోటీస్. వెరీ థ్రిల్లింగ్ టు సీ సో మెనీ బ్రైట్ ఫేసెస్ టుడే హియర్. వై ఐ డూ దిస్ ప్రోగ్రామ్, ఐ హ్యావ్ అ రీజన్ ఫ్రమ్ ద భాగవతం ఇట్ సెల్ఫ్. ఐ విల్ టెల్ యూ ఇన్ ద శ్రీమద్ భాగవతం పరీక్షిత్ టెల్స్ అస్ ద ఫైవ్ బెనిఫిట్స్ ఆఫ్ హియరింగ్ శ్రీమద్ భాగవతం. What five benefits you will get? Because you all have come to hear a pastime from Srimad Bhagavatam. So some people think, what is the need of sitting and hearing for long hours? What benefit will I get? Because we are living in a world where everybody wants to know the fruits of any action, benefits of any action. So Parikshit says, Yata shinvato apaityaratir vitrishnam satpam cha shudyat చచిరేణ పుంసః భక్తిర్హరౌ తత్పురుషే చ సఖ్యం తదైవ హారం వదమన్యసే చేత్. హీ ఈస్ టెలింగ్ దిస్ టు శుగదేవ గోస్వామి దట్ ఎనీ వన్ హూ హియర్స్ కృష్ణ కథ ఫస్ట్లీ బెనిఫిట్స్ బై యత్ శృణ్వతో బై హియరింగ్ విచ్ అపైతి అరతి. హీ సేస్ యూ బికమ్ ఫ్రీ ఫ్రమ్ డిస్టేస్ట్ ఫర్ హియరింగ్. హీ సేస్ హౌ డు యూ నో పీపుల్ హ్యావ్ డిస్టేస్ట్? Sometimes when you hear a Bhagavatam class, slowly people doze during the class. And that is a sign of distaste. When, on the other hand, when we hear some gossip about somebody, immediately the ears become erect. They hear very attentively, isn't it? What happened? Tell me more about somebody. But when we hear Krishna's glories, then ears don't stand erect, they go down. We don't hear it attentively. But he says that, if you hear Srimad Bhagavatam regularly, then the distaste will go away and taste will arise. Apaiti arati, he says. For example, the small babies, when they have to change from breast milk to some other cerelac or eventually chapati and all that, you know, idli, dosa and all they have to eat. That is a phase where children don't like. As soon as mother brings a idli or something, they will run away. The other side. Mother has to chase after them. Similarly, the neophyte devotees, if you call them for classes, they will run away. You will have this experience in Bhakti Vriksh. When you start Bhakti Vriksh outside, new people programs, you will see that new people are difficult to get. How many of you experience? They have some excuse, right? 1 week they come, 3 weeks they don't come. They are very similar to those children who run away. But somehow or other, if a child is made to eat chapati or idli or something, you will find after a few months the child gets used to it, habituated. Now that you all have grown up so much, nobody needs to chase after you with the food. Now you go with your plate and eat yourself.
Similarly, a devotee by hearing and hearing and hearing, gradually the taste awakens. The distaste goes away and the taste awakens. Then you wish to hear regularly. On your own, you may open the Bhagavatam and read. Some people may say, I don't get time to read Bhagavatam. If I only have time, I would have read it. And that is not an excuse very acceptable, because we get time for things which we like to do. Somehow you make time, you will see that. One time I asked my senior, Radha Gopinath Prabhu, how he makes time for reading. He said, I will practically show you, come to Bombay. So I went to Bombay. So he gives a program in Bhaktivedanta Hospital Monday, every Monday he used to give. So when he was going from Grant Road, Chowpatty to Mira Road, in the train, it was such a heavily packed train. But there he took the Bhagavatam like this. He was having hardly any place. He was reading like this. Yeah. And then after the journey was over, he told, you asked me how I read Bhagavatam, this is how I read Bhagavatam. So, just like for example, imagine somebody gave you Alfonso mango. Big mango, plumpy and pulpy mango and very small seed. And very fragrant also. So you got it. Now nobody is at home, so you start eating the mango. Suddenly, somebody comes and batters the door. Immediately you will be disturbed. He will think, who is this fellow disturbing me? Then he will just keep it down, wash your mouth, wash the hands, and go to the door. In 2 minutes, you will finish off the person. And then close the door, again come back and pick it up again. So like that, people will pick up Bhagavatam if they have developed taste. If you are reading something, you will keep a paper or something and go out, talk to the person, come back and again say, where did I leave it now? And continue from there. So that type of taste will come when we regularly hear Srimad Bhagavatam. He says, those who regularly hear Nityam Bhagavat Seva, they will develop such a taste for Bhagavatam, he says. Secondly, he says, apaiti aratir, and then vitrishna is saying. You know the word vitrishna comes in Bhishma's pastime also. Etima tirupakal pita vitrishna, like that he says. Trishna means thirst. Vitrishna means no thirst or no hankering for material enjoyment. So when you get Krishna, you become free from Trishna. Because Krishna fills your heart. So then the thirst for material enjoyment goes away. For example, all our holes are hankering for more and more. Like mouth is one hole which wants more and more prasad. Correct, no? Similarly, the eyes always want to see beautiful objects. And the ears are always eager for hearing very sweet music. But all the holes in our body can completely become satisfied when you fill them up with the supreme hole. Who is supreme hole? Krishna. Therefore, when you hear Krishna Katha, then we become peaceful and satisfied. Vitrishna means the hankering goes away. Just like now all of you have finished your lunch prasad. So you are satisfied. Do you think anybody has to give you a certificate that you are satisfied? No. You yourself know it. Similarly, by hearing Bhagavatam, you will feel satisfaction. The hankering and greed will go away. We will not be thinking, oh, they have such a big house, they have a big car, I don't have it. You will not feel that. You will be completely satisfied in whichever position Krishna has put you in. That is second one. Sattvam cha shuddhyati. Sattvam means the heart. Shuddhyati means purify. The hearing of the Srimad Bhagavatam will purify your heart, he says. Now, why should I purify my heart? If you don't purify, then our heart filled with anarthas like kama, krodha, lobha, they will always be stinging us with the lower tendencies. Naturally, people with lower natures, they have to cut a sorry figure in front of others in this world. Because the anarthas are the ones which make us speak harshly, or be lusty or angry or greedy. So many times even people who are very rich, very big and all have sometimes shown the lower natures. Prabhupada was telling, I just heard a couple of days ago, there was an Edward VIII in Britain. This fellow, he became attracted to a common society girl. At that time Baldwin was the prime minister. He told him in Britain, see, you are a king. You can't be attracted to a common girl like this. Either you marry her and become like a common man, or you hold the king's post and you have to give her up. What do you think he chose? He chose to marry her, that common society girl. And he gave up his kingship. So later on he lamented that out of sentiment I did this mistake. But it was too late. Later on George VI became the British king after that. So why I am saying, in this world, lust has made monsters out of men and witches out of women. It is said. So men become like monsters because of lust. So if you really are, somebody is keen to clean the heart, to make it free from lust, anger and greed, then one should read Srimad Bhagavatam. So he says that with Krishna, all the hankering goes away. He says. Like for example, Ravana had Mandodari, such a chaste wife. Why can't he be satisfied? He is now going in the Devaloka, Asuraloka, everywhere, finding out other women and bringing them to Lanka. And finally, when he caught the hand of, you know, goddess of fortune, he was destroyed. Finally, you will see that. So these are all abhadra in the heart. Nattaprayeshu, abhadreshu. So the Bhagavatam hearing will destroy these abhadras. And everybody has their own lust. Lust doesn't necessarily mean attraction only to opposite sex. Lust also means like children are adamant to get some balloon. And my mother or father may say, balloon will burst and all the money will be lost. Why do you want a balloon? You say, no, I want it at any cost. Or a child wants a cocoa chocolate. He will see that. Similarly, in every age, there is, we are lusty for something, adamant. So similarly, anger, greed. These three Prabhupada prominently says are the abhadra which will be cleaned up, and when it is cleaned up, the hankering goes away with Krishna. Yachinvato apaiti aratir vitrishna satvam chashudyati achirena pumsaha. Achirena means very quickly it will happen, he says. And then he is saying, bhaktir harau means for Lord Hari, bhakti will awaken in our heart. How? As you keep hearing the katha, gradually one will feel the presence of Krishna in one's life. Krishna will become more and more important. See, in our lives, we all are revolving in some orbit. Like somebody is revolving around an IT company, trying to make more and more money eventually and get promotion. Similarly, young boys revolving around a girl. Similarly, you know, young children, they are revolving around the games and toys and everything. Teddy bear and tricycle and everything. Everybody's mind is revolving around something. Or a married man with some children is 30, 35, 40, he's revolving around, you know, making better facility, better home, better money, better future. So everybody's mind is revolving around some thoughts which are predominating our minds. You can see that. But when you hear Srimad Bhagavatam, gradually you will see that Radha and Krishna, the divine couple, become the central figure for our contemplation. The pastimes of Krishna in Vrindavan, you know, going for herding the cows, calves, playing with cowherd boys, dancing with cowherd girls, and performing pastimes with Yashoda and Nanda, the Vrindavan will become a very fixed absorption for a devotee as one keeps hearing Srimad Bhagavatam regularly. And it all begins with hearing the name, form, qualities, pastimes and activities of the Lord. So he says that bhaktir harau, you will get bhakti bhav. So all of you sitting here, at one time or other in your life, you had some few droplets of bhakti that you experienced, where you felt some devotional emotion. So His Holiness Navagindra Maharaj used to say, if you don't have devotion, then you have no emotion for Krishna. If you have no emotion, you will only create commotion for others. So those who don't have devotional emotion, their heart doesn't soften. When it doesn't soften, they will create commotion in lives of other people. They will create trouble for other living beings. So therefore, bhaktir harau, and then he says, tat purusheta sakyam, which means one develops friendship with other devotees. In the beginning, we don't even know what is the meaning of a devotee. Like I used to see in our temple, you know, one boy used to come. When class would be going on, he will never mind about the class. He will straight away go to the deities and offer a flower and offer obeisances and push off. And he kept on doing it for about 3 months, 4 months. Almost every day or alternate day he would come. Because he was rendering devotion service, Lord became pleased with him. And the Lord inspired him. And then he turned and saw One day he heard the speaker speaking class. Then he decided to sit. Then he sat and heard something. And then he started coming to everyday class. Mm-hmm. And then when he did Nityam Bhagavad Seva, slowly I was observing. The Tilak came, Kantimala came, Dhoti Kurta came, everything. Then later on he brought his wife also. And she was a new lady. And she also got Tilak, Kantimala, everything came. Later on, after some years, I saw they both had two children. And they were also wearing Tilak, Kantimala, everything. So I observed this family in the last 20 years, how everything started. He started with just offering some flower to the deities. At that time, he had no understanding of the value of association. But because he rendered service to Lord, Lord inspired him in his heart that it's not enough for you to just give me a flower and go away. See, class is going on. What are you doing? You are not attending. So Lord inspired him to hear the class. And because of regular hearing, now he became initiated devotee. Whole family is initiated now. So, therefore, Bhaktir Harau, if you do bhakti for Lord Hari, eventually that Purushecha Sakyam, he became friendly with devotees. Now what happens with us, if you don't hear Bhagavatam, we become quarrelsome with devotees. And anybody is quarreling with devotees or amongst devotees or rumor mongering, that means they are not reading Bhagavatam regularly. That's one of the proofs. Generally what I used to do, if some devotee comes to tell me some gossip, something would say, then you tell me, Prabhuji, wait a minute. Can you tell me a nice sloka from Bhagavatam? Yeah. Immediately, he will become so shut as if you put a plaster in the mouth. He can't just quote one sloka. He will say, Prabhuji, I'll come later, he will say. See, when you tell them to glorify Krishna, they cannot speak one word. When you tell them to gossip, they can speak hours and hours. So therefore, our quarrelsome nature, fault-finding nature, will be driven out when you hear Bhagavatam regularly. Bhagavatam has that potency to purify us. And also it increases our value for the devotees. Why? In Bhagavatam, for example, in third canto, Kapila talks about, how one jiva, one living entity is higher than the other and higher and higher. Finally, he says devotees are the highest. Similarly, you read Rishabhadev. Rishabhadev also says higher and higher and higher category. Finally, he says, I am Lord Vasudeva, I am the highest. But I worship the devotees, so they are superior to me. Like that he says. Rishabhadev says that. So in these two places you will read about value of devotees. Similarly, Shukadev Goswami also tells Parikshit, Muktanam api Siddhanam, Narayana Parayana. In that verse he says, Bhaktas are Kotishvapi Mahamune. One out of crore becomes a Pakka Krishna devotee. So here you can see so many Krishna devotees are sitting. Every one is actually one in a million. So when you see them, we feel very overwhelmed. How blessed I am, how fortunate I am. But that overwhelming respect comes for devotees by regularly hearing Bhagavatam. So what are the five benefits I told you? Apaiti arati means distaste will go away. And vitrishna means material hankering will go away. Sattvam shudyati means heart will become purified, abhadras will be destroyed, nashtaprayesh abhadreshu, that is samshidati. And bhakti harau, devotional service to, devotion to Lord Krishna, and bhakti bhava for Krishna will awaken. You will feel attracted to Krishna. Right now, our attraction for Krishna is most, greatest attraction is in the form of prasadam. And now, when eventually, as we hear, similar attraction will come for the deities, for the holy name, and for the holy katha. And actual Bhagavatam class begins after the Bhagavatam class gets over. Because when Bhagavatam class is over, how do you know you have Bhakti Bhav? Class is over while walking in the road, going, coming. The thoughts about the Lord's pastimes and what Lord spoke, what the devotee spoke. How wonderful is Lord? How is Bhaktavatsal? How is Dinabandhu? How is Karuna Sagar? How is Anatha Rakshaka? Is Apat Bandhava? All these qualities of Lord will dominate your heart helplessly. They will so much dominate your heart that actually you may be sitting in a train, sitting in a bus, going, coming here, but these pastimes will haunt us. Like Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is called Goloka haunted. Like we say, hell bent, we say he was Goloka bent. Who? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So that is the benefit of hearing Srimad Bhagavatam. And Bhakti Harav, and last one, Tat Purushita Sakyam. What is that? Friendship with devotees. Correct, friendship with devotees. So you keep hearing regularly and we will get these five benefits. And I have chosen the pastime of Sudāmā for the next 4-5 months, we will complete it. Every month, 2 hours we are doing. And there are actually many valuable practical lessons to be learned. Although in India, everybody knows this pastime, Krishna Sadam pastime. Many mothers, fathers tell their children, beta, see, Sudāmā was very poor. In India, they call him as a kuchaila. Kuchailam malinam shyamam, like that, there is a verse. It comes in the same section. Kuchailam actually means he wears clothes which are wrinkled and clothes which are tattered. Very poor brāhmaṇa, Sudāmā. So many mothers say that, you know, Kuchaila was very poor and he had a great friend Krishna, who is Dvārakādīś, and his wife told him to go and fetch some money from Krishna. So Sudāmā went. He just met his friend and they had a nice talk. When he came back, then they tell about the beautiful big house which came and hundreds of servants and servant maids. And this is well known in India. But if you go to Bhagavatam, there are many intricate lessons to be learned. There are 10 prominent lessons in this chapter. I will just tell you the heading, and then as we proceed, they will all appear one by one. Importance of taking shelter of ashram. Brahmacharya ashram or grihastha ashram. Importance of the ashram is explained. And about grihastha ashram, how grihastha ashram should be detached life centered around Krishna. And the third lesson, training is foundation for any ashrama. That means ashrama doesn't mean we just remain in brahmacharya ashram or grihastha ashram. We have to get training and education under the spiritual master. That is the third one. Training is the foundation. And the fourth one, our training should be for pleasing Krishna and becoming liberated from material entanglement. These two are actually the goals. We should rise beyond three gunas and we should endeavor to please Krishna. And that is the goal of the training. And you will see in this pastime how Sudāmā's only goal was to please the Lord. No other aspiration. And then we also will learn how to serve the Guru faithfully and lovingly. There is one section where Krishna and Sudāmā go to forest and serve their Guru. Very nice section. And sixth lesson, how Krishna sets an example for personal friendship with Sudāmā. He shows an example how devotees should relate with each other. Prita Lakshanam, how it should be done. Krishna teaches it himself. And seventh lesson on what is goal of Guru Seva. The service to Guru means it's for Guru's pleasure. A disciple serves with dedication and selfless surrender with no expectation. Then there is one section on benefits of Vaishnava Seva. You get many benefits of Vaishnava Seva, like satisfaction, stability, success, peace, many things you get. Benefits of Vaishnava Seva or Guru Seva. Then there is one lesson on association of devotees is the highest benediction. It is a benediction better than seeing Lord face to face also. Association of devotees. Like when Dhruva Maharaj saw Lord Vishnu, he offered one of the prayers. Bhaktim muhu prabhatam tvayime prasango bhuyadanantamahatam amalashayanam yenancha solbanamuru vyasanam bhavabdhim neshe bhavad gunakatam ritapanamattah. He's telling, O Lord Vishnu, your darshan is very beautiful, but you are not going to remain here forever. After some time you will go back. Then how can I remember you? And then he says, therefore I beg you for association of devotees, in whose company I can remember you at every moment. Because devotees keep on reminding us about Krishna. So he said, association of devotees is better for me than taking even your darshan. So he was looking at Vishnu and requesting for association. Similarly, Narasimhadev appeared in front of Prahlad. And Narasimhadev asked Prahlad, what benediction you want? Anybody knows what he asked? There is one famous verse he said, evam janam nipatitam prabhavahi kupe kama vikamavan yaprapatan prasangat kritpatma sat sura rishina bhagavan grihita soham katam navisruje tava brithya sevam. You know, he is saying, when I look at you, Lord, I am fondly remembering my spiritual master, because of whose mercy I am seeing you face to face. Therefore, what can I ask you other than service to my guru? Just allow me to be in the feet of my guru and just go on serving and pleasing him. So both these fellows, both are children. Prahlad is 5-year-old boy, Dhruva is also 5-year. Both are asking for association of guru and Vaishnavas, which we are all getting very abundantly. Correct, no? Only we have to recognize the value of it. If we recognize the value of it, then we will know it. This is even a rarer gift than taking darshan of the Lord also. And then lastly, how a best leader means a humble servant. That is the meaning of best leader. So all these lessons are going to come. So my style of conducting this Krishna Rasayanam program is, I go verse by verse in the Bhagavatam. If some sections are very exhaustive, then we may not read all the verses. We may skip some. But most of the verses we cover.
శ్రీరాజోవాచ భగవన్యాని చాన్యాని ముకుందస్య మహాత్మనః వీర్యాణ్యనంత వీర్యస్య శ్రోతుమిచ్ఛామి హే ప్రభో.
లైక్ దిస్ పరీక్షిత్ ఇస్ సేయింగ్ నౌ. వన్ ఆఫ్ యు కెన్ ఆపరేట్ ద కంప్యూటర్, యూ కెన్ కీప్ ఇట్ దేర్ విత్ యూ. యూ కెన్ ఆపరేట్ దిస్ యాజ్ ఐ ప్రొసీడ్ విత్ ద వర్సెస్. యూ కెన్ కీప్ read the translation, take the mic. So in text number 1-5, Parikshit is asking questions to Sukadeva Goswami.
Then Parikshit said, "My Lord, O Master, I wish to hear about other valorous deeds performed by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Kukumbha, whose valor is unlimited."
Yeah. Kona Shutva Sakrat Brahman ఉత్తమ శ్లోక సత్కథాః విరమేత విశేషజ్ఞో విషణ్ణ కామమార్గణైః. యా
ఓ బ్రాహ్మణ, హౌ కెన్ ఎనీవన్ హు నోస్ ద ఎసెన్స్ ఆఫ్ లైఫ్ అండ్ ఇస్ ఇన్వెస్టెడ్ విత్ ఎండెవర్ ఫర్ సెన్స్ గ్రాటిఫికేషన్ గివ్ అప్ ట్రాన్సెండెంటల్ టాపిక్స్ ఆఫ్ లార్డ్ ఉత్తమ శ్లోక ఆఫ్టర్ హియరింగ్ దట్ రిపీటెడ్లీ?
యా, సో హి ఇస్ సేయింగ్ Visheshagnya means a person who knows the essence of life. What is the essence of human form of life? To go back to Godhead or to please the Supreme Lord. One who knows that, how can he not develop a disgust for sense gratification? And how can he not be attracted to Krishna Katha? Like that he is asking. If you see the purport, read the purport.
Srila Krishna Chakravarti comments here that we see many persons who even after hearing the topics of the Lord repeatedly give up their spiritual dedication. The Acharya replies that the word Visheshagnya is therefore significant here. Those who have actually understood the essence of life do not give up Krishna consciousness. A further qualification is to be Vishanna Kama Marganai, disgusted with material sense gratification. These two qualities are complementary. One who has experienced the real taste of Krishna consciousness automatically becomes disgusted with inferior taste of material pleasure. Such a genuine hearer of the topics of Krishna cannot give up hearing about the Lord's fascinating pastimes.
Okay, so I will give you one homework verse from Bhagavad Gita 9.3. You can read, The 9.3 verse, there is first class devotee, second class devotee and third class devotee. So Prabhupada says that a third class devotee comes to ISKCON, Prabhupada says, for some material motivations. Like if somebody doesn't have a job, he thinks congregation devotees are all well situated in life, so he may come for a job opportunity. Once he gets a job, he'll go away. So some people come to temple to get a match for their daughter or son. In Vedic temples also, they used to do that. Many of the families, they would go to the temple and see the other members in the community or the same caste and everything. People do that. So Prabhupada says, these are all considered which class devotees? Only third class. Because they have no other interest, their material interest only. Some people thought, oh, in this temple they have free prasad. So I like prasad. So Krishna is very intelligent. He, through prasadam, he attracts people. Finally, the fellow dedicates his life fully. Started with prasad. So the third class devotee comes for some material motivations, and he has neither knowledge of Krishna nor faith in Krishna so much. Very superficial. And the second class devotee doesn't have much knowledge, But he has great faith. He feels that, oh, Lord is in the deity form, so beautiful. Bhaktas are all doing such nice bhakti for the Lord. Actually, this material world is temporary. I have to also become a bhakta. So he has some implicit faith. And on that faith, he continues coming, and the faith becomes thicker. Gradually, his knowledge increases. And the first-class devotee has very deep knowledge, and he can defeat all false arguments and everything. Knowledge also. And he has faith also, very deep-rooted faith. And that devotee practices with the heart. So therefore, as he says here, some people, if they are visheshajna, how can they not develop disgust for sense gratification? That means if somebody says, I am a devotee also and I want to enjoy sense gratification also. Prabhupada once said, sense gratification and Krishna consciousness go. He said, well together or ill together? Ill together. You can't keep two legs in two boats. What will happen if you keep two legs in two boats? And if two boats go in like this, you will fall in the water. Correct, no? So therefore, as devotees, we should actually be in the process of increasing our Krishna consciousness and reducing sense gratification gradually, not abruptly, because there is one verse in 11th canto which says, Sve sve adhikare yanishta. Sat, like that parikirita, there is one verse. It says that if you are in Shraddha stage, there is vidhi nishet for you. Then sadhu sangha, bhajanakriya, anarthanavrita, nishta. So in every stage, there are some things you should give up, some things you should accept. Like you accept something and give up something. Like that you go. Like in one Bhakti Vrsha program, one family had come, new family, they were only chanting one or two rounds. And the Bhakti Vrsha leader told strongly that we have to give up coffee. So they gave up the program only. And 6 months they didn't turn up. Later on the leader was wondering why they are not coming. Then he found out that they are attached to coffee. Then he told them, please continue drinking coffee but don't give up Krishna. Then they brought him back to program. So therefore we should give up things gradually according to our level of Krishna realization. As we param drishtva nivartate. Again param drishtva nivartate. Every stage it's varying. But Parikshit is actually a very deep devotee, convinced devotee, powerful devotee. So he says that if somebody knows the essence of life is to hear about Krishna, why will they be attracted to sense gratification? For example, before coming to Krishna consciousness, some of us might be interested in cinema magazines or sports magazines or watching movies. Some people would watch a movie and come back and tell scene by scene what was the first scene, second scene, third scene and everything, isn't it? People used to, I've seen people buying cinema songbook also, like we have Vaishnava songbook. We have cinema songbook, isn't it? Now we don't have that taste, correct? Now we are fed up with that. It's disgusting now. So, in America, Prabhupada said, I have come here to convert crow-class people into swan-class people. So, who are we? Are we crow-class or swan-class? So, we have some white feathers and some black feathers. So, we have to remove the black feathers completely. So, we will only have? Then we will completely become swans. So, till then, when we read Bhagavatam, gradually understand what are the black feathers, what we have to give up. And then he further speaks. See what he says, Parikshit. Savatnyaya tasya gunan grinite karau chatat karma karau manascha smaret vasantam stirajangameshu shrinoti tat punyakata sakarnaha. Translation?
Actions, speech is that which describes the qualities of the Lord. Real hands are those that work for Him. A true mind is that which always remembers Him dwelling within everyone living in non-moving. And actual ears are those that listen to sanctified topics about Him.
Yeah. See, these kind of sections come in Bhagavatam in a few places. He's saying, our tongue should not be used like a frog who is always making tr 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 sound. You have seen that when I was studying in Vada, we had a new experience in Vada. In the rainy season, so many creatures would come out. When you are walking on the muddy road, you will see some crabs crawling and crossing the road. Sometimes you will see small snakes also moving, crossing the road. Sometimes you find, so when in the rainy season, the snakes come out of the holes. because all the holes are filled with water. But the snake cannot see and find out. The snake senses by vibration. And he doesn't know where the frog is, but the frog helps him to find out. How? Making sound. He makes the sound. So Prabhupada says, anybody who speaks karmi subjects and useless topics, so they are exactly compared to what? Frogs. There is one verse which says, Bilebato rukrama vikramanye na shrinvata karnapute narasya. Like that he says, Jihvasati dardurike vasuta nachopagayat turugayagata. So we should not use our tongue to talk mundane topics or topics which, again plunges into sense gratification. In Bhagavatam, the word kukata is used. Kukata, matigni. Matigni means which destroys the intelligence. Brahma says this in the third canto, 15th chapter end. You will see Brahmaji tells one very important verse. Yenna vrajantyaga vidho rachana anuvadat. What is the first line? Yenna vrajanti agabido agabit. Aga means sin. Agabit means one who destroys sin. Who is it? Who does aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshishyami? Who does? Yeah, that's what agabit means, Krishna. Yenna vrajantyaga vidho rachana anuvadat. Rachana means Bhagavatam. So the pastimes of the Lord are written in Puranas and Bhagavatam and everything. People who don't delight in them, what they do? Shrinvanti ye anya vishaya kukata mati gni, he says. They hear anya vishaya means what? Cinema magazines, time pass magazines, which they buy in the trains, dirty pictures, dirty stories and everything they hear. They are called mati gni. Mati gni means that destroys our good intelligence. Yastu shruta hata bagay nribirata saras tam stam kshipanti asharaneshu tamasuhanta. Very frightening verse. He says, what happens to those who read other literature? Asharaneshu means they become shelterless in life. Tamassu means hell. Kshipanti means they are cast into the dark hell without any spiritual shelter. And they suffer for a long period of time. Like that he says. And he is actually warning demigods, don't do any other katha other than Krishna katha. Similarly, here also he is saying, And the hands are those which work for him. In the Bhagavatam, there is another place which says, Shavau karavano kurute saparyam. That is in another place. See, if there is a Jamindar's wife, she's wearing a very costly sari and her hand is full of golden bangles. But those hands with bangles are considered to be Shavau karav. What is the meaning of Shavau karav? Hands of a dead body only, it is said. Why? Because they are not engaged in cleaning the mopping the temple room at home. Some people become so preoccupied with TV nowadays, then the temple room cobwebs are coming. What is the meaning of a cobweb in the puja room? See, if TV becomes very big, the puja room becomes neglected. Otherwise, when you go to some homes, the altar is very big altar. You ask them, where is the TV? They say, now the TV is in kitchen, now we are using for keeping hing and other items. They don't see the TV now anymore. So the TV represents material life and altar represents spiritual life. So we have to check which is bigger. Is there a big altar or is there a big TV? And faithfully people sit in front of TV, husband, wife, children, dada, dadi, nana, nani, everybody sitting. It's called one-eyed guru. Famous guru who attracts everybody and keeps them submerged in illusion. So therefore, it is said that if a hand is not used for mopping the Lord's temple, then such a hand is called Shavav Karav, it is said. Similarly, actually ears, those listen to sanctifying topics. Actually, our ears should hear Krishna Katha. If they hear Maya Katha, then our ears are compared to snake hole, bilay. Bilay bato rukrama vikramanye. Why snake holes? There is a reason. Inside a snake hole, what lives? Snakes. Similarly, snake-like material desires will reside in our mind if we hear something other than Krishna Katha. So some of you may feel that these verses are very strong, but I am just repeating from Bhagavatam. You will find this. There is another verse which says, Bharaparam pattakirita yushtam nanamen mukundam api uttamangam. You know what it says? Yeah, a man had a very big turban. Very big turban. And he doesn't bow down to the Lord. Like once, two PhD boys had come to ISKCON temple. So one PhD boy is a devotee. So he bowed down to deity. Other fellow was standing and watching like this. You know, his friend told him, "Hey, why didn't you bow down?" No, I don't bow to anybody. He was telling. So, therefore he's saying, if somebody is wearing a turban and is very proud that I am great, I won't bow down. That turban is compared to a heavy, very heavy gold crown for a drowning man. Imagine somebody is in ocean. You take a very heavy crown and keep on his head. What will happen? He will drown further. Correct, no? So, Bharaparam. Bharaparam, he's saying. Bhara means weight. Bharaparam patta kirita jushtam. Nanamen mukundam. He doesn't bow down to mukunda. Like that he says. So, therefore, one should use the ears to hear about Krishna. Otherwise, ears are like snake holes, it is said. And similarly, eyes, if somebody's eyes are not used for seeing the deities, they are compared to plumes of a peacock. Why? Because plumes of a peacock cannot see. They look like eyes, but they cannot see. Similarly, the eyes which are not used for reading Gita, Bhagavatam, they are compared to wounds. You know, there is one Thiruvalluvar in South India. He says that anybody who does not use his eyes to read the scriptures, his eyes are like wounds. There are two wounds in his face, he's saying. These two. They are not eyes, he's saying. Because they are not used for reading the scriptures. Shirastutasyo bhayalingamanamet tadeva yat pashyati tadhichakshuhu Angani Vishnu Ratata Jananam Padodakam Yani Bhajanti Nityam.
Yeah. An actual head is one that bows down to the Lord in his manifestations among the moving and non-moving creatures. Real eyes are those that see only the Lord. And actual limbs are those which regularly honor the water that has bathed the Lord's feet for those of his devotees.
Yes. If you really have actual head, that should bow down to the Lord. The real eyes means one should see the Lord, with the Lord's deities. And all the other limbs of the body means which honor the water that has bathed the Lord's feet. Means charanamrit, which is sprinkled with charanamrit on our head. So, this section 1 to 5 actually is talking about the different limbs of the body, how they should be engaged in Lord's service. Actually, if you faithfully do this, what he is saying here, Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur in 11th canto, one commentary, he says, "My dear Lord, you have stolen away my eyes." He says, "Why? After seeing the beauty of your deities, I don't want to see any other beauty. After eating your prasad, now I am unable to eat out in hotels now. Because we eat only your prasad. After hearing your Krishna Katha, all other novels and TV serials and all have become boring now. There is no more interest for us after hearing about your Katha," he says. So, in this way, he says, "Ever since I gave my senses to you, you are the Rishikesh. You have taken away my senses. Now I am sold out to you," like that he says. And then he says, in this world people steal money, people may steal some commodity, but you are a very intelligent person, you steal all the senses of everybody. There is one song, Vraje Prasiddham Navanita Chauram Gopangana Nam Chadukula Chauram Vraje Prasiddham Navanita Chauram Gopangana Nam Chadukula Aneka Janmarjita Papa Chauram Aneka Janmarjita Chauragraganyam Purusham Namani Chauragraganyam Purusham Dhanam Cha Manam Cha Tatendriyani Dhanam Cha Manam Cha Pranamscha hrutva mama sarvameva. Pranamscha. Palayate tatra kutonya chaura. Tonya chaura. Tvam bhakti dam nasi maya niruddha. Tvam bhakti dam nasi. Raja prasiddham navanita chauram gopanganam chadukula chauram. Raja prasiddham gopanganam chadukula chauram. Anek janmarjita papa chauram. Anek janmarjita papa chauram. Chauragra ganyam purusham namami. Chauragra ganyam purusham namami. In this song, the poet is saying, my dear Lord, within the age of 1 to 5, you stole butter in the homes of different gopis. And between the age of 5 to 10, you stole the clothes of the gopis in Chirgad. And now you have come in my life to steal away all my sins accumulated in millions of lives. And I know that by associating with you, such a transcendental personality, I will become free from all my sinful reactions. And you are not just a thief, you are the leader of all thieves, he is saying. Chauragra ganyam. Why he is saying? Because in this world, the thieves steal some chota mota things. They steal some commodities, money, car, things like that. But you, dhanamcha, you take away the wealth. There are so many kings who have left their kingdom and run to the forest in search of Krishna. The Gopi Gitam, if you read, the last verse in Gopi Gitam says, gopis are saying, my dear Lord, you are so attractive that even great kings have given up their worldly empire and gone in search of you into the forest. Like that they are saying. So, dhanamcha, manamcha. Why manamcha? Because sometimes when a person becomes a wealthy man becomes a renunciate, then many people criticize him. His man, reputation is spoiled sometimes. Dhanamcha, manamcha, tatya indriyani. Pranamcha hrutva. You even, you take away the whole existence of a devotee towards yourself. Mama sarvameva. And then he is asking, palayate kutra, hey, after taking all these things, hey, thief Krishna, where are you running away? He is asking. Not only Krishna takes these things away, he slips out from devotee. Can you say why he slips out from devotees? See, Krishna takes these things and slips out from you so that you can chase after him. The more you chase, there is more suspense. He doesn't come in your grip very easily. He increases the suspense more and more until we completely bow down to him. And when you completely surrender to him, then he will surrender to you back. So he says that I will capture you and I will tie you with a rope. What rope? Karmapash? No. Yamapash? No. Bhavapash? No. Because all these pashas he has cut. Yamadutas, when they came, Yamapash was cut by Vishnadutas. Krishna can cut Bhavapash also, Karmapash also. So I will bind you with which rope? Prem Pash, he's saying. With the rope of love which Yashoda used to bind you. So he's saying that I will bind you and I will put you in a dark jail, which is my own heart, he says. For how long? For eternity. For all, this is the punishment for you. Because you attracted me, you have to stay here now. Like that he says. So, in this way, Bhaktivinoda, this is the fourth verse we read. One more, fifth one. Now, Sutta Goswami is speaking. Sutta Vuvacha. Vishnuratena sampristo Bhagavan Badarayanihi Vasudeve Bhagavati Nimagna Hridayo Abravit. Yeah, read the translation, please. Yeah, correct. Who is Vishnurath? Parikshet, yeah. Who was protected by Lord Vishnu in the womb of his mother. And who is Badarayani? Shukadeva Goswami. So, why Badarayani? Because there's a Badri tree in the, Badrinath. Under which Vedavyasa sat and wrote all the literature, and he is Vedavyasa's son. So, Badarayani. His heart fully absorbed in meditation on the Supreme Lord Vasudeva. Sri Shuka Uvacha. Here starts the pastime of Sudāmā. In verse number 6 and 7, five qualities of a brāhmaṇa are mentioned now. If any of us have taken brahman diksha, we can, it's one good for us to check these qualities. You can verify how many of these five qualities we have. Krishnasyasit sakakaschit brahmano brahmavittamah viraktayindriyartheshu prashantatma jitendriyah. There is one more verse. We will read that and then we will discuss. Yadrityayopapannena vartamano grihashrami tasya bharya kuchailasya krikshama cha tada vidha. See, Krishna se asit, there was a sakha kaschit. There was one particular friend of Krishna, he says. And who was he? He was a brahmana. And brahmavittamaha, which means he was not an ordinary brahmana, he was most learned brahmana. In brahmanas also, there are people, there are various categories. There is vipra, there is a purohita, and there is a brahmana. You must have heard this saying, janmana jayate shudraha, and then you say, sanskarad bhavet dvija, vedapatad bhavet vipra, brahma janati iti brahmana. Four categories are said, you see. By birth, everybody is a shudra. And then, janmana jayate shudra, samskarat bhavet. When do you become dvija? When there are 40 sanskaras to be done, 10 of which are prominent, beginning with garbhadhan sanskar. See, garbhadhan sanskar is before birth, and antyeshti is after death. And in between, there are another 38 sanskaras. But 10 of which are very prominent, like the namakaran sanskar, Annaprashan sanskar, like the different sanskaras. So, but if somebody has gone to the Guru's ashrama and got a second initiation, who gets it? Three people get. Brahman, Kshatriya and Vaishya. So, all three get sacred thread. But out of which the Brahmana is called not only Dvija, is called Dvija Sreshtha. Brahmana is called Dvija Sreshtha. So, Bhagavatam, often the word Dvija Sreshtha will come, you will see. Dvija Sreshtha means generally Brahmana. Others are called Dvija also. So, now if somebody is a brahmana, he is a dvija, but he is not learned, then he is considered like a bird. Why a bird? A bird produces an egg first, and then the egg hatches and produces another bird. That means the birth of a bird happens two times. First birth by egg, second birth by hatching of the egg. So, a dvija has double meaning. One meaning is if you are learned brahmana, then you are a dvija. Otherwise, you are only like a bird only. Like that he says. So, he was a brahma vittama, means very learned brahmana. He was well learned in the Guru's ashrama, in Sandipani Muni's ashram. That means a very realized brahmana. Not just sometimes in South, we find some brahmanas come to do this shraddha and all at home. In our home, we used to have old brahmanas used to come, but now their descendants are not proper brahmanas now. I heard that they go for watching movies. Some of them are starting eating omelette also. So they have become impure now. And when they look at their face, you can easily understand that they are not following proper lifestyle of a brahmana. But they still, nevertheless, they come because they can collect some dakshina. Attraction is there. And all their profession is going on father's name or grandfather's name. So that is not a proper brahmana. So, and then virakta indriyarteshu means, he says that he was detached from sense gratification. Prashantatma means always he was peaceful in mind and very composed in mind. Mind was not agitated. I don't have this, I don't have that. No, mind was very peaceful. And Jitendriya, he had conquered his senses. So these are qualifications of an ideal brāhmaṇa. So when we talk about Jitendriya, that means the senses should hear the soul's instruction and follow. Not that the senses give dictation and we act according to their dictation. For example, you will see that we become impelled by the invitations given by the objects of the senses. For example, if somebody gives me a sonbabdi after my lunch is over, already I am full. But somebody brings a giriraj sonbabdi, then I feel, anyway, Prabhu, I cannot say no to prasad. People take it, correct, no? Yeah, you shouldn't say no, but take it and keep it. You can eat tomorrow, no? But then we think that, no. Then people quote that shloka which Sarvam Bhattacharya quoted. Prapti matrena bhaktavyam. Prasad should be eaten as soon as you get it, because you don't know whether you will live tomorrow or not. Prapti matrena bhaktavyam. Okay, if you want to follow that verse also, you can take little one speck of it. Why do you eat the whole thing? Correct, no? So therefore, we have to check whether senses are controlling me or I am controlling the senses. So that's what makes difference between Godas and Goswami, correct? So he was Jitendriya, and he was Prashantatma, peaceful in mind. We are living in an age when people's minds are very active, hyperactive. There is a mind filled with shoka, moha, bhaya. Shoka means lamentation. Moha means illusion. Bhaya means? So such a mind cannot be peaceful. But yasyam vaishrune manayam krishne paramapuruṣe bhaktirudbhattite pumsam shokamoha bhaya. Krishna katha will make our mind prashantatma. Regularly if we hear. And also he says, virakta indriyarteshu, detached from all sense enjoyment. Actually, in our neophyte stage, we may be very fascinated by sense gratification. Think of the days when you are coming first to ISKCON temple. One of the first things that fascinates us is the prasad, varieties of prasad. Some people say we have never eaten such items like in ISKCON anywhere before. Okay, that's very good fascination, no problem. Be attracted. Even Prabhupada told the devotees, eat like a duck. Prabhupada told the new devotees who would come, eat well, give him more, Prabhupada would say. And he called that ISKCON bullets, So recently I went to one devotee's house for giving Bhagavatam. So he was telling me, Prabhu, I came to ISKCON attracted by ISKCON bullets and ISKCON bombs, he said. What are bombs? Books. Prabhupada called the books as bombs. And he called the ISKCON bullet as gulab jam. And he said, now I am only continue to be attracted to bombs, Prabhuji, but not the bullets, he said, because I have got diabetes now. Very mystically he was speaking. So, later on Prabhupada also told devotees, don't eat so much gulab jamun, not good for you. But devotees, Prabhupada, you only told us to eat. And Prabhupada said, that's all right, I told you to eat, now I am telling you not to eat. So therefore, we also have to develop this virakta indriyarteshu. Actually, we all can study our life, which are the indriyartha to which my mind is still attracted. Keep it secret, you can know it yourself, you don't have to tell anyone. But you can see that, like Dhruva Maharaj had a desire to get a Dhruva Loka before. But gradually, by the performance of devotional service, that desire got purified. Similarly, we also might have come with some material desires here. But as we progress, we have to get rid of those desires. Like when I went to South, I saw one man, he was almost 78 years old. Some people are still having energy even at 78, 80 also. You've seen some fellows? This fellow was one such fellow. When he was watching TV, he was watching cricket all day. Whenever somebody puts a sixer, he would be jumping from the seat, clapping hands, hey, see, like this. So I told that fellow, next life, you will have to be born again to play cricket. Because what is your age now? At 78, you can't be like a kid, interested in so much in cricket. Because by the age you are 78 or 80, you should be preparing for ante. If you are so much jumping and clapping hands for cricket, that means you need one more body for playing. Is that agreeable or not? What do you think? Yeah, whatever our mind is imbued with, we get such a type of body. Very dangerous it is. That means he doesn't have virakta indriya arteshu, correct, no? He's still fascinated. So all of us can check, before coming to Krishna consciousness, we had certain wrong fascinations. Now have they gone away or are they still there? What do you say? You don't have to tell me. That you can find out. I will find out for myself, you find it for yourself. What are the fascinations we had before? Are those fascinations proper now? If they go, if they are not favorable for Krishna consciousness, we have to give them up. Yeah. And then next verse he says that yadrichi opapannena. That means, you know, one should be satisfied with what comes of its own accord. Yeah. Isn't it? Like for example, in the Ramayana I was reading, you know, Dasharath, when he would meet the brāhmaṇas, he would give the whole kingdom to them in charity. Now you may say, but how will he rule the kingdom then? But the brāhmaṇas will not keep the kingdom, they will give it back in charity. Because brāhmaṇas do both dan and parigraha both. Brāhmaṇas will say, my dear king, what will I do with the whole kingdom? I give it back to you, take it back. They will give it back. That means kings never feared that whether brāhmaṇa will give back or not, how can I give him the whole thing? They were so bold. If you read the fourth canto, Prithu Maharaj worshipping the four Kumaras, there also you will see, Prithu Maharaj says that, oh brāhmaṇas, all my kingdom belongs to you and you have given me in charity, therefore I am ruling the kingdom. That was their consciousness. That means, you know, even the kings were not greedy. They were actually, yadurchiyopapannena means satisfied by what Krishna has sent me. Actually, the greed is a very, very big, there's a saying in Hindi, lobh paap ka baap hai, which means greed is the father of sinful activities. Because greedy people will always pull the leg of others and try to get more and more, they will never be satiated. And their mind is always preoccupied. Therefore, you will see, it's very easy to say, like one man was telling, if you have two cows, keep one and give one away to somebody. What is the problem? So then one man had a question in the class. Sir, if one has two cars, what to do? He said, that you don't ask me. He said. Later on, I asked the speaker, why you said that? He said, because I have two cars, he said. You understand? Because he had two cars, if he says, keep one car and give one away, then what he has to do? He has to give also one away. So generally, you will see greed is such a thing that we have a tendency to accumulate more and more. No? And we all can, when you go back, you can check how many pens we have, how many pencils we have, what are things which we have but we don't use. How many of you feel we have things which we possess but which we don't use, which we also haven't given away to anybody? So once when I read this, I immediately went back to the room and I found a dozen pens I found. Different people had gifted me. I immediately gave it off to other devotees. Don't keep it with us. Because we should use what Krishna has given us and give away that which we don't use and not feel greedy for things which we don't possess. We should know that it is not good for me. If Krishna hasn't given me something, it is not good for me. Krishna knows best. Whatever he has given me is good enough. Many times we don't use things given to us, but we are looking at others what they have. First of all, we are not using what we have. We are not doing. So should you look at others' plate or you should look at your plate? When you are eating, both? Just look at our plate. How much that fellow is eating? So he's saying, don't. So he was actually satisfied. So let us go further. Now the wife is approaching Sudāmā and she speaks. Very important verse, 8th verse. Pativrata patim praha mlayata badanena sa. Daridram sidamana vai vepamana abhigamyacha. See, his wife is coming to him. She is called as the Pativrata Patim. Why? Her nature was, why she is called Pativrata here? She was never concerned about herself. But she was only concerned about him. Actually, she was also suffering from Daridrata. She was also very skinny, but she never mentioned to husband that, look at me, how skinny I have become, I haven't eaten well. You know, what is the use of marrying a man like you who was a Daridra fellow? You know, he's not maintaining me. She didn't say like that. Actually, the Vedic life means they always think about the spouse first. They don't think about themselves first. I was reading in Ramayana that when Lord Ram came to know that he has to go to forest, you know, he came to Sita and told her, that, hey Sita, it's the order of my father that I should go to jungle. But don't worry, this 14 years will pass like a moment. I'll be back very soon. And you remain with the three mothers in the palace peacefully. And I will remember you and I will come back very soon. And Sita was shocked. She said, what are you talking? She said, for a woman, being with the husband is like being in heaven. Being away from the husband is like being in hell. She said, even the soft beds in the palace will be like a bed of thorns for me without your company. And she said, instead, if I come with you to forest, I can see the beauty of the mountains and waterfalls and the chirping birds. And with you by my side, I have nothing to worry, she said. And then Ram said, no, no, no. In the jungle, there will be lions and tigers, you know, praying for food. If I am alone, I can manage myself. But if you are there, you know, you won't be able to bear the fear. And also he said, in the jungle, we may have to eat kandamool and roots and berries and all. You won't get good food. In palace, you can eat very nice foods here. And also he said, night, there is no place to sleep. We may have to sleep under trees. Snakes may be crawling. Any ferocious animals, they generally come out during the night time. There is no cottage to live. There is no palace which has got doors and, you know, latches to live comfortably. Keeping all this in mind, I thought, Sita, it's better for you to remain back. And Sita loudly cried. She cried, is this the reason why my father gave me in marriage to you? She said, and then she said, you see, you go to forest for 14 years and come back, but you won't find me alive when you come. She said, I will either consume poison and die, or I'll enter fire, or I will drown myself in some river. But you will not find me alive. And then Lord Ram pacified her, patted her and said, hey Sita, don't worry. I can't live without you even for a moment. But I just was joking. I just conducted a test to check with you whether you are prepared to come. Now that you have passed the test, don't worry, I'll take you with me. Like that he said. So I was thinking when I read this, imagine if a husband has to go to forest for 14 years. He will naturally go to wife and say, hey wife, husband and wife are like half of body, you know, Ardhan Arishwar. Therefore, he may tell his wife, so you also have to come with me to forest. And wife will cry loud and she will say, no, 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 punishment is only for you, not for me. Isn't it? And he may say, but no, no, but that is all right, punishment is for me, but who will cook for me in the forest? She will say, better you take Lakshman or somebody with you, you know. If you, and I will teach cooking for him and he will cook for you. But she didn't behave like that. She is worried about whom? And Ram is worried about whom? This is the way husband-wife relationship is supposed to be. You see? So here also she is worried about whom? And Sudama is worried about whom? Himself or who? Actually, same way in the Vedic life you will see, you know, parents always think about how to benefit the children. And when the children grow up, they always think how to keep the parents happy. In India, these sentiments can be very nicely seen. Children are very attentive to make parents happy, especially in their old age. In fact, in India, many times there is a competition between sons that I will keep the father with me. I will take care, you don't worry. So, and that is actually an ideal relationship where the parents worry about children and children worry about parents. Not that children think about themselves and parents think about themselves. That such a selfish life can never be satisfying, you see. Here, Sudama's wife is worried about Sudama. Patiprata, patim praha, she told her. Mlayata badanena, see her face was dry. And see the mana, she was very distressed. And she was also trembling, it is said, while approaching him. Why? There is a reason given here below in the purport. She could not obtain food to feed her husband. She was fearful to approach the husband because she knew that her husband is a high quality devotee, pure devotee. He will never agree to go to Supreme Lord for begging for any alms. She knew that. Still, she was very shy to tell him, but nevertheless, she thought that I have to tell him now. Nanu Brahman Bhagavatah Saka Sakshat Shriyapatihi Brahmanyascha Saranyascha Bhagavan Sattvatarshabha. Yeah. Translation?
O brāhmaṇa, is it true that the husband of the goddess of fortune is the personal friend of your exalted self? That greatest of Yadavas, the Supreme Lord Kṛṣṇa, is compassionate to brāhmaṇas and very willing to grant them his shelter.
Yeah. See, here Chakravarti Thakur gives a very beautiful commentary. He says that whatever Sudama argument he may present, she is having ready-made answer for them. Huh? Sometimes when you meet somebody, you anticipate some arguments, correct, no? And then you keep answers ready, and as soon as they put an argument, you shoot back with answer. That's what she did. See, he is asking, Sudama may ask, how can Krishna, who is the husband of Lakshmi, you know, befriend a fallen soul like me? Like that Sudama may ask. In reply, she is telling, no, he is called Brahmanya. Namo Brahmanya, go Brahmana. You can't say that. Although he is husband of the goddess of fortune, Lakshmi, he is very fond of Brahmanas. He always spends time with Brahmanas. You know, he's washing the feet of the Brahmanas and all. Like that she says like that. And then he may say that, oh, I have no real devotion for the Lord. He may say like that. And then for that she replies by saying, oh, he is a great and wise personality who would surely obtain the shelter and mercy of the Lord. She is saying that, oh husband, you say you have no devotion to Krishna. I have witnessed myself. You know, day in and day out, you are remembering your eternal friend every moment. You have great devotion. And you are not only devoted, you are also very wise and learned also. And Lord Krishna is very fond of you. So therefore, don't object to going. And then Sudama may say, how can I go and ask Krishna, you know, extending my arms, please give me something. How can I ask? So to that she is telling, if you go to Dvārakā, even if you don't ask Krishna, the other fellows will look at you. So niggardly dressed and tattered clothes and bones and everything. They will just take one mushti of diamonds and give in your hand. That is enough for the whole life. Their other fellows are also very opulent there. Naturally, you know, you don't even have to ask. You just go and see Krishna and come back. Like that she is telling. So, seeing his situation, she was very worried. Tamupaihi mahabhaga sadhunam chaparayanam dasyati dravinam bhuri sidate te kutumbine. Read the translation. Yeah. She's saying sadhu namcha parayanam. He is actually the shelter of all saintly people, and you are very saintly in nature. So you have nothing to worry, you just go and approach him. Aste aduna dvaravatyam bhojabrishnyandakeshwarah smaratah padakamalam Atmanamapi yachati kim dvartakaman bhajato natyabhishtan jagadguruhu. Yeah. See, here she is saying Krishna is actually always residing in Dvaraka, because Sudama may say that maybe Krishna may be out of station. He may say, no? So for that she is giving an answer. No, Aste aduna dvaravatyam. He always resides in Dvaraka. He doesn't leave very easily. That is his base, main place. He will not move out easily. Most of the time he is there only. Not only that, he is Bhoja, Vrishni, Andaka, all the dynasties are all under him. He is the Ishwara. He is the master of all the dynasties. And then she is saying, Smarataha Pada Kamalam, Atmanam api achati. Any devotee who thinks of Krishna's lotus feet, Krishna gives himself to the devotee. Atmanam api achati, she is telling. That is his nature. See, in this particular point, it's important to meditate on this point of Krishna's ability to reciprocate. It's very powerful reciprocator of even insignificant service rendered by his devotee. Like for example, once when Krishna came to Indraprastha, Draupadi gave some fruits in a plate along with a knife. Krishna cut the fruits and little blood drops popped out. Seeing that Draupadi took her end of her costly silk sari and she tore one strip and she gave it in Krishna's hands and said, please wrap it in your finger. So Krishna felt very moved. She told Draupadi that, you know, you didn't mind tearing from your costly sari. Not that Draupadi was running around searching for the clothes. Is there any extra, you know, torn clothes available? She didn't search. Immediately she responded spontaneously due to her devotion to Krishna. Krishna said, I have to reciprocate with this love that you have shown me. How did he reciprocate? By how much sari he gave? She gave one strip and he gave unlimited sari. Because we have only two hands to give, but Krishna has how many Vishwarupa hands? Sahasra Shirsha, Sahapurushaha, Sahasraksha, Sahasrapad. So he has Sahasra Pani also. Thousands of hands with which he can give. So therefore he is saying, if anybody remembers Krishna's lotus feet, Krishna gives himself to the devotee. There is a reason why he gives himself. That is said in the Ambarisha section. Lord Vishnu speaks to Dhruvasa Muni. He says to Dhruvasa, my dear Dhruvasa, you have come to a wrong place. Although I am residing in Vaikuntha, I won't be able to save your life. Dhruvasa asked, but my dear Lord, somewhere I heard the shloka, namo brāhmaṇe-devāya, go brāhmaṇa hitāya cha. You are very dear to brāhmaṇas and all I heard. But then Lord Vishnu said, that is true, but Vaishnavas are more dear to me than brāhmaṇas also, he said. And then Dhruvasa asked, why so? What is the reason? Then the Lord said, look at this Vaishnava Ambarish and look at you, brāhmaṇa. It's an encounter between Vaishnava and brāhmaṇa. When the Sudarshan Chakra followed you, you ran under the ocean, under the water. You ran into the caves. You ran to Indraloka. You ran to Brahmaloka, Shivaloka, everywhere. And finally you have come to me. Because you know ultimately chakra comes from my hand only. So you have come to me. How much you are afraid to save your life? On the other hand, look at Ambarish. When you created the demon, Ambarish just folded the palms and smarataha pada kamalam. He meditated on my lotus feet. And what was his meditation? Rake Krishna Mareke. Yeah. If Krishna wants to save me, no power under the sun can kill me. If Krishna wants me to die, then I will not prevent my life. He was ready. Same with Parikshit also. Lord protected Parikshit in the womb of his mother, correct? Therefore, he came to be called as Vishnurat. But when the snake bird, Takshaka, was about to bite Parikshit, did Parikshit beg the Lord to save his life? Why? There is one verse which says, why he didn't pray? He knew that if Lord wants me to be saved, he will save me. But if Lord wants me to hear the Bhagavatam in 7 days and go back to Godhead, I should go back. I should not try to prolong my life artificially. So the devotees of the Lord are so deeply rooted in devotion to Lord. Whatever is Lord's plan, they will accept. So we should not try to... Nowadays, people prolong the life by putting some ventilator in the nose. You've seen that? And the person... he cannot talk also. I don't know what will you gain by prolonging life. For a long time, people remain like that. You've seen that? Few, probably 1 or 2 months, they can remain like this. They spent a lot for the oxygen. So, actually, by prolonging life, we don't gain anything. So, Parikshit decided that Lord wants me back in spiritual world. I will go back to him. I will not remain here. But in the time of birth, he wanted to protect me. So, that is his wish. So, Ambarish was exactly like that. He was decided, if Lord, I think it's my time of death has come, Lord wants to kill me through this Rakshasa, no problem, he accepted. So Lord Vishnu told Dhruvasa, look at you, look at him. Therefore, I like Vaishnavas more than Brahmanas, he said to Dhruvasa Muni. And then Lord told one more thing. There are two qualities in a Vaishnava which fascinate me very much. One is, my Vaishnava devotees don't want anything from me. They don't want Indra Padavi. They don't want Brahma's post. I am ready to give one brahmaṇa to each Vaishnava. They don't want. They are not ready to accept such a position. And what to speak of that, even moksha they don't want. Moksha wants also they don't have. Liberation also they don't want. You know, then the Lord is asking Vaishnava, pure devotees, what do you want then? The devotees say, I don't want anything, Lord. I just want your service. Sometimes you will see in homes also children, you know, kua, kua, kua. And the child is crying. Mother throws a balloon or some toy, teddy bear, and the child catches the toy and keeps quiet. You have seen. That means these are like semi-devotees who capture some goods from the Lord and they are happy. They will not aspire anything beyond that. But there are some children which keep on crying. Mother gives toy, she gives lollipop, she gives different things, you know, some video game in a mobile. Nothing the child wants. And the mother is asking, what do you want? Why are you crying? The child says, I want you. Then mother understands. Now there is no other way. Then she picks up the child on her lap. So Lord said, my pure devotees are like that. They want what? They want only me. They don't want nothing. They don't want anything else. So Lord said, this is one quality in my devotee. They don't want even moksha also. They want only me and my service. Another quality, the Lord said, my devotees are even more compassionate than me also. I sometimes feel if somebody is a mischievous jiva, I say, chodo, leave that fellow. But my devotees are more sympathetic. They tell me that, my Lord, let me give a try once more. Like Nityananda Prabhu is more merciful than Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Lord said, the compassion that resides in the heart of my devotees is something very fascinating to me, the Lord said. Why the devotees are compassionate? Because the devotee's heart is carrying compassion, which is a part and parcel of Radharani's compassion. Radharani has ocean of compassion and the devotees have a drop of compassion from her compassion. And Krishna is the total tattva and the jivas are all part and parcel of Krishna. So every jiva is Krishna's part and parcel and every jiva's compassion is Radharani's part and parcel. Like that. Compassion of her part and parcel. So Lord said these two things. What are the two things fascinated Lord Vishnu? No desire. Nadanam, najanam, nasundarim. But nama janmane janmane ishware. That is one thing that fascinated the Lord. What is the other one? Compassion of the heart of the devotee. Especially compassion to deliver the suffering souls. So Lord Vishnu told there. Similarly here also you find Atmanam. And the Lord Vishnu told Durvasa, my devotees don't want anything but me. Please repeat that verse. Sadavo hridayam mahyam. Sadu naam hridayam tvaham. Madanyatena jananti. Naham tebhyo managapi. My dear brāhmaṇa, understand this. My devotees do not, he says that my devotees reside in my heart and I reside in the heart of my devotees. And my devotees don't know anything but me and I don't know anything but my devotee. This is a very beautiful verse it is. So this is the pure love that exists between Lord and his devotees. So therefore, smarataha pāda kabalam ātmānam api yacchati. If you remember Krishna's lotus feet, he will give himself to you completely. One time, Muchukunda king, after helping the demigods in a great battle with asuras, and the demigods won the battle, and then he requested them, please allow me to sleep now. For too many days, I have done a lot of hard work for you fellows. And then he asked for a benediction from the demigods. Can you please give me a blessing? When I am sleeping, if any guy comes and disturbs me, if I look at him, that fellow should be burned down to ashes. And the demigods told, no, none of us will disturb you, don't worry, war is over already. He said, I can trust all of you fellows, but there is one fellow who is Indra. He can disturb me, even if there is a slight possibility of any danger, he will come running to me and disturb me. Like recently, you know, one plane was flying through Gulf borders and they suspected that the plane is coming to drop bombs. They shot the plane, 270 people died. It came in the paper recently. So when people sometimes are suspecting that they could be enemies, they shot, you can see that. So he also told Muchukunda, he told the devatas that Indra is always insecure fellow. He may come running to me and wake me up for small reasons. So therefore, tell Indra that you are giving me this boon. What boon? That anybody I look at, I will burn them down. So will Indra wake him up? So with that benediction, he was sleeping in a cave. So at that time, Lord Krishna came to the cave, being chased by Kalayavana. And then Lord Krishna didn't want to touch Kalayavana. He was a very sinful person. So Kalayavana thought it is Krishna who is sleeping in the cave with a covered blanket. So he gave a kick to the person who was sleeping. And then when he took the blanket and looked at that fellow, what happened? Only bones were there. The whole body got burned down to ashes. And then this Muchukunda turned around and looked at Lord Krishna standing there. And he looked from top to bottom, nothing happened to Krishna's body. Rather, his effulgence in his eyes got diminished. So then he told Krishna, "My dear Lord, you cannot be an ordinary person. Ko Bhavan," he asked, "who are you? Are you Surya Devata? Are you Chandra Devata? Are you, who are you? Are you some Gandharva? Are you Agni? Which Devata? Are you Vishnu? Who are you? Please reveal about me. Reveal to me about who you are. I see that your feet are not touching the ground. You are standing on a lotus. You are certainly an extraordinary personality. You are emanating effulgence which is spreading in the whole cave. And my eyes, effulgence has become diminished." At that time, Krishna told him, "My dear king, you are my pure devotee. In the previous life, prarditam prachuram purvam, you worshipped me very intensely and you had a desire to have my darshan. So now I have come to give you darshan." So Lord told him, which means if you have done your homework, Lord will wake you up and give you darshan. But if you haven't done the homework, even if you run after him, you won't get darshan. It will take time. Therefore, first we have to do our homework, as Lord told him. So, in this way, Krishna reciprocated with Muchukunda. Correct, no? So, therefore, he is saying, Smarataha Pada Kamalam Atmanam Api Achyati. Draupadi, also in the forest, when she remembered Krishna, when Durvasamuni and disciples had come, immediately Krishna came. So, this is the method of getting Krishna to come in our lives, by remembering him. And the remembrance comes from Shravanam and Kirtanam. Shravanam, Kirtanam leads to Smaranam. Yeah. For increased hearing, chanting leads to increased remembrance. So, we will do two more verses and then we will, two, three verses we will do and then we will leave it here. Sa evam bharyaya vipro bahushah prartito muhuhu ayam hi paramo labha uttama shloka darshanam. Very amazing thing here. See, his bharya, his wife is telling him, "Go to Krishna, get some wealth. You are very skinny, you are very bony, you are not eaten for many days. Whatever food you get, you are giving me and my children. You look at you." She is worrying about whom? Sudāmā. But Sudāmā's contemplation is different. What he is saying? "Oh, you are telling me to go to Dvārakā. I am ki paramo labha. I have a very great advantage in going to Dvārakā. What is it? Uttama shloka darshanam. I will see Krishna eye to eye. Iti sanchintya manasa gamanāya matim dadhe apyastupāyanam kinchit grihe kalyāni dīyatām." See, thinking that, if I go to Dvārakā, I will get darshan of my very, very close heart-to-heart friend, Krishna. Thinking, iti sanchintya. Thinking like this in his mind, manasa, gamanāya matim dade. He made up his mind to go to Dvārakā. See, the beauty of devotee's heart is, others may be talking from one point of view, but devotee's heart is always thinking, how can this situation help me to serve Krishna better? That is devotee's thought always. Like once, Kamsa called Akrura, and Kamsa was thinking, this Krishna Balaram, these two guys are hiding in the bushes of Vrindavan. I send Agasur, Bakasur, Keshi, so many demons. Every time these fellows hide behind the bush and kill all the demons. Now I will get them out of Vrindavan to Mathura. And I will arrange for Chanar, Mushtik, Shala, Toshala, all of them and finish these fellows. But then who will bring Krishna Balaram? Who can call them? I should send somebody who is my man, but whose invitation Krishna will accept. And who is that man? He chose Akrura. Then he thought, but Akrura may deny also, no? Likely he may say, why do you want to bring Krishna Balarama and kill him? So what to do, he thought. Then he got a new golden chariot. No, completely new golden chariot, unused, fresh one. And then he called Akrura and said, Akrura, I want to give this chariot to you to go to Vrindavan and bring Krishna Balarama. And Akrura had a smile on his face. Why do you think he smiled? Actually, Kamsa thought Akrura is smiling. You know why? Because, you know, I have bribed him with a new chariot. Huh? Because sometimes if you are very fond of driving a car or a bike, imagine somebody gives you a bike or a car with, you know, even the plastic is not removed and the rubber smell is still coming, fresh smell. Huh? Now your hands are itching to use the bike, isn't it? So he also thought that Akrura is looking at the chariot and becoming attracted. So in this way, I have convinced him to bring Krishna Balarama. But do you know why he was smiling, Akrura? Two reasons. One reason is, I am going to get a chance to see my very dear lords Krishna and Balaram. Another reason is, this Rakshasa Asura has used so many things. At least one good thing is giving to Krishna, which is bhoga, which is not used. Why is the chariot bhog? Unused. It's fresh offering to Krishna. So Krishna Balaram should get fresh one, not a used one. Therefore he smiled. So Akrura smiling was not understood by Kamsa, because Kamsa was not such a devotee. Akrura is a devotee with favorable attitude. Similarly, here also Sudāmā is smiling happily. Okay, my dear wife, you are telling me to go, I will go. But his mind contemplation is different. Oh, I can meet my Gurukul friend. We can have a good chat. I'm seeing him after a long time. He's my lord and master for me. Iti sanchintya manasa gamanaya matim tade. And then he see what he does. Immediately he's asking, apyasti upayanam kinchit grihe kalyani diyetam. Okay, good wife, now if I am going to Krishna, how can I go with empty hands? Is it proper to go to meet somebody with empty hands? See, in India, there is a norm people have. If somebody gives you in a dabba, some carrot halwa or something on a birthday, they give you. Will you give the dabba empty back to them? You put something else. You put some mitai in that and give it back, correct? No? That's the method of reciprocation also, correct? No? Similarly, in San Francisco, Prabhupada was telling devotees that the hippies, he was telling, when you come to temple, you should bring a flower or you should bring a fruit. You don't have to bring any big thing. Even a small offering should be brought, because Krishna says, patram pushpam palam toyam. You should bring something. So it is a habit in India. I had gone to one, in my travels, one Balaji temple in one village, remote village. So I just went for darshan there. But there were almost 60 to 80 very old people. There were 20 men and 60 ladies. All of them above 80 years. Very dried up bodies, very, very weak also. But they were actually sitting and reading Vishnu Sahasranam Stotra. So they saw me in this dress and immediately told that Pujari, can you please tell Swamiji to give us a lecture, something from Bhagavatam. So I wasn't made and planned, but because they requested, I spoke to them for an hour. So on Samudra Manthan Leela, I spoke and they all enjoyed very much. So after the katha, I saw all these ladies came and some of them gave me 50 pais. You know, some of them gave 1 rupee, some of them gave me 2 rupees, some of them gave 5 rupees, like that. They all came and put, and almost every one of them, it's a tradition in the villages, they have a habit of giving like that. So, of course, I collected all the money and went to the pujari and gave it to him. He was very happy. Because the poor temple, for them in remote places to maintain also is difficult for them. I gave it to him. But the reason I was telling you, we should always think when we go to meet somebody, we should take something with us to give. Especially when you go to meet the Lord, you should take something with us. One should not go with an empty hand. So, the amazing thing is what? He himself, his stomach is completely empty. He has not eaten. He's very bony, skinny, and tattered clothes he's wearing. But still he's thinking what? What can I take for Krishna? That means a person who is a have-not, he wants to give something to Krishna. That is the nature of a devotee. A devotee will never tell Krishna that you have not given me anything, how can I give you something? He doesn't say like that. Even when I have nothing, I have to give something. Like that, his mind is thinking like that. Yeah. Very. Yeah, and then This section will end here now. Yeah. Ya chitva chaturo mushtin. Vipran prutukatandulan. Chailakandena tan badva. Bartre pradat upayanam. So, yachitva means they didn't have anything to give Krishna. So, what they did? Yachitva means begging. She begged to the neighborhood people, can you please give something, at least some flat rice, chipped rice or something. Chaturo mushtin means four mushtis, four palmfuls. She took it and vipran, prithukatandulan. Prithukatandulan is that flat rice. Chaila kandena tan badva. She prepared and gave him, and then he tied it in a cloth. And then she gave it as a gift to Krishna. Satanadaya vipragya prayayau dvārakām kila Krishna sandarshanam mahyam katam syāt iti chintayan. Yeah. See, after taking it, that packet, he tied it in his hip and he went towards Dvārakā. At that time in his mind, what was the thought going on? Krishna sandarshanam mahyam katam. Katam syat means, will I be able to get darshan of Krishna, or maybe the dwarapals may stop me from meeting Krishna, or there may be some obstacles because kings are generally very busy people, or maybe, you know, Krishna in Gurukula days, he was easily accessible and approachable. Now that he has become a king, maybe he might have become very busy. He may say, not now, come another time. He may send me back. Possible, no? So, katam syat iti chintayan. So, he was thinking, will I be able to really get his darshan? And then he thought, okay, even if I don't get his darshan, making an attempt is not a bad idea. I can make an effort to go and see him. And then the verse number 16 onwards, it is a section starting after he goes to Dvārakā. So, let us still be with Sudāmā only. Where was Sudāmā? Sudāmā was in Porbandar. You know Porbandar? That is Gandhi's place also, yeah. So, Sudama's place was somewhere in that locality, but from there he is going to Dvārakā now. So, we also will remain with Sudāmā now for this class. Next class we will go to Dvārakā. And he goes to Dvārakā, and then what he saw in Dvārakā, everything we will read. Śrīla Prabhupāda ki. So, for all of you, 2:30 is a good time. Should we start at 2 or 2:30? Okay, today I got a bit late, but I will generally stick to my timing also, 2:30 to 4:30. I don't exceed a minute. So you don't have to worry whether Prabhuji will forget the time and keep going on and on. I will end on time. So like this, every time I will cover little section. This pastime may take about 4 or 5 sittings, I think. 5 sittings. And it will keep progressively going ahead, and many more lessons will come. All of you are most welcome again. Thank you. Śrī Prabhupāda ki. Can I do 5 minutes kirtan? Hi, Damrindanga, ready? Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna.
Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Krishna Krishna Hare Radhamadan Mohan Radhamadan Mohan Radhamadan Mohan Radhe Jaya Jagannath Swami Jaya Jagannath Jaya Baladeva Jaya Subhadra Nittai Gauranga Jaya Nittai Gauranga Nittai Gauranga Jaya Nittai Gauranga Haribol 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 Nittai Gaura Haribol 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 Nittai Gaura Haribol Kaliyuga Pavana Harinama Sankirtan Ki Srila Prabhupada Ki Samaveta Bhakta Vrinda Ki Grantaraj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Nitai Gaur Prema